Hi, I'm Stephen Feuerstein, and I write practically perfect PLSQL. Welcome back to another coding therapy session with Stephen Feuerstein. So my focus today is on couples. I'm going to do some couples therapy. And first, I'm going to do therapy for developers and database administrators. And then we'll tackle developers and their managers. So, developers and DBAs, can't we all just get along? Apparently not. There's a longstanding animosity that sometimes arises between developers and DBAs, and this partly results from kind of different objectives and different ways of looking at things. For a developer, we want a lot of flexibility. We want to move fast. If I need to add another comp to the table, let me do it. If I want to do X, Y, and Z, let me do it. DBAs are generally more control-oriented. They're responsible for the database. They don't want you to just make whatever change you feel like making and then have to deal with the aftermath. And of course, there's the common scenario of your code not running fast enough. You go to the DBA and say, you know, could you add a couple more indexes onto the table? That's what I think is going to make the application run faster. And what does the DBA say? Tune your application first, as if I didn't already work really hard to tune my application. Oh, that's right. I haven't really worked all that hard to tune my application. So the bottom line is that the DBA is usually right about things like this. And in fact, you know what? The bottom line is that the DBA usually has more authority and responsibility than individual developers, which means you're unlikely to win a fight with a DBA. So you don't want to get into fights with the DBAs. You want to have a nice collaborative relationship. And you also want to watch out for and figure out what to do about DBAs who are maybe not on the top of their game. Because it's one thing to have a DBA who's putting obstacles in your way and you're saying, it's frustrating, but I kind of get it. And it's another thing when you run into a DBA or a group of DBAs who are putting obstacles in your way and you're looking at those obstacles and you're saying, are these guys idiots or what? Let me give you an example. Years and years ago, I worked as a consultant shortly after I left Oracle in 92. This was probably about 1994 or 5. And I worked at an insurance company downtown. And we were building an application on SQL forms against Oracle database. And one day we came in Monday morning to continue our work and all of our code was broken. None of it would compile. And we started to look into what was going wrong. And we had lost access to all of the built-in packages, DBMS output, DBMS SQL, you name it, all gone. What's going on here? Called the DBAs, who worked actually in another company that had acquired the insurance company that I was working in, so we had major ivory tower differences that way as well. And they said, we just realized that in the Oracle model with PLSQL, when you create a stored procedure and you grant execute authority to some other user to run your stored procedure, then for the duration of time that that person, that user out there, is running your procedure, it has all the privileges, all the power of the owner of that procedure, of me. Okay, we said, yeah, we kind of know that. And then the DBA said to us, well, look at the built-in packages. They're owned by sys. So that means that when you call a database built-in packaged program, you're running with all the authority of sys. That's obviously a very dangerous thing. We couldn't allow it anymore. So they disabled access to all the built-in packages. I know this sounds like a joke. You probably don't believe me, but this actually really happened. Now, as I'm sure you also know, it's just not true. It's true that that's the default model, the definer rights model for executing programs in the database. But of course, Oracle thinks these things through pretty thoroughly. And they did not make all the power of the sys schema available to anybody who was running any of the built-in packages owned by sys. So that was a completely false thing, a completely false understanding, which totally disrupted our development, probably for a few days before we got it sorted out. Maybe they were just playing with us. Maybe they really, really didn't like us, and they wanted to mess with our brains, but I don't know. They seem to be rather sincere about it. Hopefully they learned their lesson. So, the key thing is, first of all, make sure that your DBAs know what they're doing. If not, not sure what you should do about that, but be careful. Second of all, assuming you've got a pretty competent DBA, and I assume that, and I'm sure that, in my experience, most every DBA I've met certainly knows more about the Oracle database than I ever have or will. Don't go into battle with your DBA. make sure it's a collaborative process whenever possible. I'll give you an example. So in my previous or my other session on shock therapy, I talked about how you should put your SQL statements inside a data access layer in API and then access the information through that. And I gave this great example of one of the advantages, the ability to upgrade to new features more quickly, the function result cache. The function result cache optimizes performance of queries against tables that are static or changing relatively infrequently. Great. So find your materialized views, build functions around the queries, they're static, make them result cache. Boom, you're golden. Faster code. Maybe. The thing is that, as I'm sure a lot of you realize, the running an application in an Oracle database isn't a matter of finding one feature or one aspect of the architecture or the language and using that to the nth degree and suddenly everything's golden. It's a lot of moving parts and they all interact. So we could put the result cache label on hundreds, thousands of functions and say, wow, we really had a good day today. We improved our application performance dramatically. Go home and your application is dead, dying in front of its users. Because, well, let's see, you can put the result cache label on your functions and you can start filling up the result cache, but the result cache has a maximum size. And if you haven't talked to your DBA about how many functions you want a result cache, how much data you expect to be stored in those caches, you could run out of space and then you're flushing out the cache through the least recently used algorithm, which means you're not getting the benefits of performance. And there are even other aspects of using the result cache in which you can bottleneck around latches. So you can't just say, cool feature, let's dive in and use it and not think it through, not explore the possible implications, and not do that with your DBAs. So if you don't already have a good relationship with your DBA, if you're not already collaborating, certainly seek them out. Ask them for advice. That's the best way in general to get in a person's good side, is to make sure they know that you look up to them, that you can learn from them, that you need help from them. Of course, you don't want to be a pest. But in general, I mean, to go to your DBA and say, listen, you told me last week that I should tune my application. You're right. I haven't done it well enough. Give me some pointers. What should I do? What do you think are the most important things to do? So on and so forth. You'll get them on your side. You'll be working together in more of a team effort and not be at loggerheads. If that doesn't work, have them call me. We'll make an appointment. We'll get you both on the couch and we'll work it out together in, like, you know, online live couples therapy. How's that? Very exciting. Yes.